No layers, no levels, only zero. 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 Welcome to the video. All praise to the three great teachers whose compassion is coming through this video and being shared with the world. It doesn't matter how many people watch the video. It's going out into the mind, the one mind. Okay. Teacher Jesus, Ananda Maya Mahat, Longchenpa, those three teachers are the ones who whose compassion has stepped up and is enabling this whole situation to be present, this teaching. And of course, even more primary is the Holy Spirit. I rank the Holy Spirit in influence as zero influence. It's the one that is giving these affirmations. Affirmations are like cutting a new groove in a vinyl record. Vinyl record has all these grooves cut in it. Whatever grooves cut in it, that's what's playing. So our mind is like a vinyl record, is all these grooves are cut there. And so they just keeps turning around and around and around, and we just keep hearing the same old song, same old song, same old song. If you want to hear a different song, you have to cut a new groove. Affirmations are like cutting a new groove. In order to cut a new groove, you really need to focus in on it. I've been saying this, no layers, no levels, only zero. 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 This morning for hours, I woke up at 4 a.m, as I usually do these days, and I just say, wow, this is terrible. I'm stuck. Just complaining, thinking, can't get any answer. It's terrible. Finally, I asked the Holy Spirit, please, Holy Spirit, I'm so stuck, I can't get any answer. And then this affirmation just sort of pops into my mind like medicine. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. And I just start saying it. And go over and over and over. I go away, fall asleep for a little while. I wake up and keep saying it. So hours and hours, you know, burning a new groove in the morning. No layers, no levels, only zero. Now, I understand this. It resonates. I say, yeah, that's the groove I want. Burned in my mind is no layers, no levels, only zero. So affirmations are powerful. The mind is just complaining. It's just playing the grooves of the record that are already there over and over and over. Help, get me out of this pit. Help, get me out of this pit. Help, get me out of this pit. Help, I've fallen into some great pit. Well, ask yourself, how can there be a pit in pure spaciousness where you're beneath the surface of pure spaciousness? How can you fall beneath the surface of pure spaciousness? How can we fall beneath the surface of pure spaciousness? How can we fall beneath the surface of pure spaciousness? No levels, no layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. Can you imagine a pit in pure spaciousness? Dig a pit in pure spaciousness. So we're down in this pit. Well, aren't we in pure spaciousness down in this pit too? Isn't the whole pit in pure spaciousness? And I have Ramana Maharshi actually to thank for this. He talked about someone digging a hole, shovel hole, and he says there's spaciousness there now. And Ramana said, there was spaciousness there before too. it's just there was dirt in the spaciousness, and now there's air in the spaciousness. And so it clicked. I said, wow, yeah, Huh. So Ramana Maharshi is absolutely a friend of this program. There's no question about it. So affirmations are the way to go. You cut the new grooves. It gets you out of spinning your wheels with the same old, what doesn't work, what doesn't work. Of course, cutting, what grooves do you cut? I mean, people are cutting grooves all the time. You can sit there and watch television, cut grooves for, 8 hours a day. Are those the kind of grooves you want to cut in your mind, is the question. Again, how can we fall out of pure spaciousness? How can we fall into a different relationship with pure spaciousness? How can we say, I'm stuck, pure spaciousness is up there. How do I get there? How do I get there? We were told we had a big fall. Adam and Eve, had a big fall. They started dreaming, fell asleep in a dreaming. They haven't woken up yet. That's in scripture. How can you fall out of pure spaciousness except in a dream? Imagination. Hallucination. Jesus calls it hallucination. Jesus is the great, the one that, as he said, I didn't come to save the world, I came to condemn it. That's in scripture too. Absolutely true. He's the one that says, there's nothing here that will ever satisfy you. The world will never remind you of your true identity. There's nothing here, and it's just like, absolute condemnation, at the same time bringing up the continuity problem. So Jesus condemns, but then also says you have a continuity problem, so it's okay to honor time. Take your time, but keep in mind that this is all hallucination. It has nothing to do with what we are, absolutely nothing to do with what we are. Sri Anandamayi Maha is the great exemplar of and exhorting us on the spiritual path to use utmost tenacity on the spiritual path. Work. Don't let a day go by that you don't increase your efforts. That's what her ceaseless message for her whole life of 86 years. Get after the path. Get after it more. Work harder. That seeped into the world. And so I got that tenacity from that source. It got into me. I said, wow, here's somebody who really cares. Here's someone that cares so much that they don't even need to be here at all. And they came here just to tell us, hey, you can get out. You can wake up. But you have to work at it like it's the most important thing in the world to you. And every day you have to try to do better. And gave the same advice, to everybody. It doesn't matter, just so that's super helpful. Then Longchenpa revealed to me pure spaciousness. I hadn't seen it before. I didn't realize this before. When I saw that, I said, oh my gosh, that's the answer. Now I see it. So he's been a tremendous trigger, a recent trigger. The Buddha of compassion, Longchenpa, is one of the great Buddhas, really. And he has the compassion to answer my call. Actually, I put out a great call. I need a boost, please. Answer the call. He answered the call. How about that? Someone who's quote-unquote supposedly left this realm, long ago, hasn't forgot about it, our situation, and it is answering the call, saying, I'm going to help out, I'm here to help out. Pure spaciousness is all important. He brought the notion of zero dimensionality to me. Zero dimensionality, pure spaciousness. I said, whoa, how do you fall out of pure spaciousness? You can't. Well, then how could I fall into a deep, dark pit? Can't, you see. So these are the three heavyweight teachers that have formed this expression here. They're responsible. And Of course, they all play second fiddle to the Holy Spirit. We all, because the Holy Spirit is with us continuously and constantly, knowing every detail of everything, helping us lessen our honoring of time so we don't honor it forever, you know. So it's speeding things up, speeding says, hey, you know, maybe if you do look at this way, you can drop your honoring. Believing that we're in a pit is honoring time. Now, how did we get into this pit? That doesn't exist. That's where, how we get into this hallucination of a pit, where we think that pure spaciousness is up there and we're down here, right? The whole dualistic idea is we're fallen, and we have to make our way back up out of the pit. Okay, this is the trouble. This is the false conception of it all. We dream that we are fallen. Our fallen nature state is a dream of having fallen. It's not possible to fall away from God. God's everywhere. How can you fall somewhere where God is not? It's not possible. So how did we start hallucinating this? Because we wanted to be greater than God. Spirit wanted to be greater than God. So it automatically, that's duality. Automatically. Instant duality. Greater, lesser, higher, lower. If there's a higher spaciousness and a lower spaciousness, then it is possible to fall into a pit, into the lower spaciousness, isn't it? The so-called lower realms. We hear about all the realms, and the seventh heaven and all these different realms, higher and lower. But in pure spaciousness, zero dimensionality, there is no higher and lower. That's reality, that's God. We can't fall out of God. We can't fall into a lower state. That's a hallucination. If it weren't for the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Sri Nanaima, and Longchenpa, I wouldn't have this, be able to see this and talk and express it here and share it. So, the ones that are clear about this make a huge difference. They're not higher than we are, and that's what they tell us. I'm not higher than you are. We say, oh, Jesus, you're so high, you're on high. My gosh, I'm down here in the lower realms of hell. You're up there in the highest purity. And Jesus says, no, I'm not higher than you are. It's impossible for any of the sonship to be higher or lower than any other aspect of the sonship. And the sonship is one with God. There is no higher and lower in reality. So these teachers are you could say they're very humble, but they're actually very truthful. They don't say, yes, I'm higher than you are. Come up where I am. They say, you're hallucinating levels. You're hallucinating depth. You're hallucinating layers, levels, depth. But there's only zero. There's only zero depth. There's only zero depth. This is a nod to the continuity problem in concepts. Zero is a concept. Depth is a concept. We say zero depth. It's like a double statement which sort of cancels itself out. It's a self-canceling concept. And this is what the Holy Spirit has shown me. Use self-canceling concepts. Zero depth. Zero depth. Now, people may say that's blasphemous. You're saying you're on the same level of Jesus. No. I'm not saying I'm on the same level as Jesus. I'm saying there are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. If there's only zero, how can there be a higher and lower? Now those who insist, no, Jesus is up there. I'm down here. What are they insisting upon? They're insisting upon spiritual pride that it's possible to be greater than God. That it's possible to be greater than God. That's what they're insisting on. And of course, they want to be greater than God. Our spiritual pride wants to be greater than God. So there's a higher and a lower. And so they're saying, no, Jesus is at the higher, I'm at the lower. It's basically saying, I believe, I'm insisting that there's something higher than God. So God is lower, higher and a lower. Of course, we say, no, God, you're the higher, I'm the lower. But it's still saying there's something higher than God, because God is one, God is zero dimensionality, and only spirit could have the whim of saying, hey, I want to be greater than God. So there's something higher than God. So there's a higher and a lower. Any belief there's a higher and a lower, that is spiritual pride. That means you want spirit wanting to be greater than God. It doesn't matter who you put higher and who you put lower. You can't hide the fact by saying, no, Jesus, you're higher and I'm lower. That's trying to hide the fact, obscure it, that it's actually spiritual pride who's demanding, no, there's something higher than God, so there's a higher and a lower. In God, there's no higher and lower. There's only what is. There's only what is. So, you can get the sense, little fly, you can get the sense of the various aspects of compassion. What are they conveying to you? Are they conveying higher and lower? Are they conveying no? All right, get the affirmation back. No layers, no layers, no levels, only zero. 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 Now, it is true that someone can come and tell us this, and we can reject it. Now, Jesus' message has been rejected for the most part, because we insisted on putting him up on a pedestal, saying, you're higher. You say, oh, great. There is something higher. This is higher and a lower. But of course, remember, Jesus washed the feet, right? The feet. He said, no. And of course we said, well, he lowered himself. No, that's not the point. He was showing us there is no higher or lower. There is no higher or lower. He didn't lower himself. People think that people lower themselves to come in this world. There is no world to come into. There is no higher or lower. So these great teachers that come appear in this world, they're not deluded in thinking, well, I descended deep down into the pit. There is no pit. Now, of course, everybody will think they did that, but they'll say, no, I did not do that. Sri Nandamayama insisted that she was not a ma, she was not a mother, she was just a little child, our friend, our sister, just walking beside us, equal. And people say, no, you're some great teacher, way up there, you're unbelievable. I said, no, all is one. There are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero, there's only one, there's only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. Now, false judgment is to look at appearances and believe that there's a meaning of layers and levels there, where there is not. There isn't any. We're just completely superimposing this demand upon all appearances. And this is what Longchenpa pointed out. No, all appearances are just the same. They're all the same. It's all the same. It's all the same. There's just this perfect sameness. And we're deluded into believing that there are levels. No layers, no levels. Only zero. Basically, he said, there's no path, but this teaching, he said, don't give out this teaching to those who are struggling on what they think is a path, because they still think there's a path. It's just that they get to quit it. They don't have to take it. That's not the teaching. Teaching is that there are no levels or layers. There's only zero. That's the teaching. So it's easy to misinterpret it. And yet to say, well, don't give this out. That's funny. That was a mode of speaking back then. Because any time you're teaching anything, it's been given out to everyone. It's already been given out to everyone. What they mean is don't try to emphasize it to those who are not, you know, ready for it. But here it's being given out freely. Anyone can pay attention or not, or at least focus in on it, or cut a new groove or not. You know, cutting a new groove is where it's at. And so those who don't get it, they won't cut the new groove. They'll just keep listening to the same old one. Oh, I get to quit the path. Basically they're saying, oh, there is a path, but I get to quit it. Okay, take care of me, or something's going to take care of me. I get to quit it. But what we're saying, there is no path, there is no depth, there are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. There are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. So, every day when you wake up, ask the Holy Spirit for a new groove. Say, what groove are we going to cut today? What groove are we going to cut today? And it's not easy at all. I have very struggled terribly. Because the problem seemed overwhelming. I want an answer for my problems. And the Holy Spirit never seems to respond to what I think my problems are. It says, just do this. Huh? But I was asking you about this, you know. I got this problem. And the Holy Spirit says, just say this. Okay, got a new groove. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. This is the way. Affirmations help you leapfrog over your perspective. They shift your perspective. What we're stuck in is a perspective. We're stuck in a perspective. And the affirmations shift us out of that perspective, and we see a new perspective where the quote-unquote problems may appear to be very, very different. What we're saying when we complain is, hey, from this perspective, I can't see the answer. Well, that's right. From that perspective, we cannot see the answer. So shift the perspective. Use affirmations to shift the perspective. And then see what, you know, what the answers are. I don't know, you know, what the answers are, but I do know that it's shifting perspective. I trust the Holy Spirit in what it's saying. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. I know that this is absolutely true. This is extremely powerful. This is extremely good groove to cut. Now, how is this going to change my life or change, I don't know. You have to have faith, in other words. You have to have faith that somehow our problems may not be what we think they are. In fact, we may have no problems. And to say this, there are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero, is really freeing yourself from time. And isn't time the only real problem that we have in terms of our delusion? The real problem we have is the continuity problem. Okay, that is a practical problem we have. Time doesn't really exist. We're hallucinating that it exists. So if we think we have a problem, it's because we think it's taking time to solve that problem. If it wasn't taking time to solve the problem, how would we have a problem? No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. So as you go about your day and you're thinking and working on your perspective, keep saying the affirmation, keep burning it in there. Road trips are like a very good thing. I'm thinking this today, why don't I take a road trip? Well, right now, the means are not there to do that, but I'd love to do it. Because on a road trip, if you're driving, like drive 8 miles or 8 hours, you can spend the whole 8 hours just burning this affirmation into you. And then you're in your car, you can yell it, you can shout it. See, right now I gotta be real quiet and talk like this. But when you're in the driving in the car on the freeway, you know, no layers, no levels, only zero, no layers, no levels, only zero. You're yelling it to the countryside, you're yelling it to the sky, you're yelling it to all the cars as you go along, all the people that can't hear you. No layers, no levels, only zero. They may think you're singing, probably. I've actually had my breakthroughs while driving into the vision of oneness while driving. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. So gosh, road trips are very nice. Great excuse. Great excuse for 8 hours of practice. Now you do 8 hours of practice intense, you're gonna burn that groove in pretty good, you know. Now, it is true that the grooves that we have are already burned in. We have been working on those grooves for, you know, so long. People religiously work on burning their grooves. Everybody does. So, you know, one day we think, what can we do in one day? Well, if you really focus on it with intensity, ferocity and tenacity and intensity, says this, no layers, no levels, only zero, no layers. There are no levels, there's only zero. There are no layers, no levels, only zero. And thousands and thousands and thousands of times, just burning it, burning it, burning it, tenaciously. This is the tenacity of Sri Anandamayi Ma. This is the tenacity that I got from her, you know. No layers, no levels, only zero. Don't give up, keep fighting for it. Then you're going to burn that groove in. You're going to get it grooved. You're going to get it grooved. You're going to get it grooved in, and you're going to find it's easier, 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 easier. So God, I pray for a road trip. I pray for a road trip, really. I've been stuck for so long here. It's been almost a year of going absolutely nowhere. But fortunately, in my work when I had it, I was driving most all the day, and I could, all day I was taping and trying to burn it in, but I was more talking. It's when you do the affirmations where you really make success. But your mind will want to kind of get familiar with the new territory of the affirmation, so it will, you will be thinking also, but then go back, no layers, no levels, only zero. 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 Now, if that's the case, then how long does it take for any what you request to be the case? No time at all. There's no layers, there's no levels, there's only zero. There's no distance in reality. The light is everywhere. So your request of the light is spontaneous. It's always spontaneous. It's always spontaneous. Or instantaneous. It's always instantaneous. We don't understand that because we keep asking light, hey light, I want a hallucination of a pit, and I want layers and levels and depth, and I want time, I want on whatever I request. I wanted to take a lot of time before it happens, and I wanted to get it, have it go through all these layers and levels, and so as it gets to me, it's all layered and level, you know, and it's not pure. See, so everything here seems so impure, you know, contaminated with time. And this, so we're hallucinating. Light is giving us this hallucination. It's our desire. So everything's totally contaminated with time. Nothing is the way we want it. Where's the purity, we say? Where's the purity? Nothing is pure. That's why we love pure food, pure water, pure this. Oh, can I just get some purity, please? Well, the contamination is time. The reason why nothing feels pure here is the belief in layers, levels, time. That's time. Jesus calls it time. This is one way to speak of it. You can also say it's belief in depth. Depth, layers, and levels. At first, the light has to go here, and then it has to go there, and it has to go down in order to get to you. You can say time, sure. That's absolutely. We believe. So that's what contaminates. It gives a feeling of contamination. Where's the purity? Where's the purity? Where's the purity? Now, when I experience my inner divine child, which is within all of us, which is reality, I experienced purity. I said, my gosh, pure happiness. No contamination of time. The happiness was completely present right now. So, but we're so used to the feeling of contamination by time that we have a continuity fear. Say, oh my gosh, I can't stand purity. So, they said, I don't, so we keep believing in layers and levels. So if I just get up to the next level, then I'll maybe be a little less contaminated. And then get up to the next level, I'll be a little less contaminated. Okay, that's honoring time. But it's very important to realize that is just a hallucination. There's no reality to it whatsoever. So it may seem as though we're going to higher levels, less contaminated with time. But we're still hallucinating. It's still a dream. There are no levels. There are no layers. There are no levels. Only zero. There's only zero. But Jesus said, that's fine, that's fine. If you want to, you need to play it out because of the continuity fear, then you can play it out in what seems to be a seeming progress like that. But, the progress needs to be brisk. It needs to be brisk, and you need to be burning in the truth that there are no levels, layers or levels. There is no such thing as time. It's not like you can say, oh, I got to a pure place, great, that's it. This is fine. Now there's higher up there and lower here, and I'm going to keep myself from falling down. Hopefully I don't fall down. And then what happens? You end up start looking down like, whoa, but make sure I better not fall there, better not fall there. And then you try to defend and protect your position. You try to manipulate time, try to keep others away from your beautiful, pure place. And so the path has to be brisk. You have to expedite it, which is again Sri Anandamayi Ma. Brisk, expedite it, push it through to the finish. Otherwise, you're going to start losing momentum and start getting pulled back into this belief in time and layers and levels. So we think of a mother as someone who's very indulgent, you know, but now this one, if you want to say that, discipline, this one. Get up, say your prayers, say your affirmations. How much did you say yesterday? Half an hour? I want you to do 10 more minutes today. That kind of mother, you know, discipline, taskmaster. Gotta, more, come on, you got to get going. More, you gotta push it here. That's super helpful. Drum the laziness out of you. You can't be lazy and succeed on the path. So this Sri Anandamayi Ma was this incredibly helpful presence of straight talk, honest talk to us. It says, hey, you cannot be lazy and succeed You must be a genius on the path. You must get after it. And steam, get rid of this laziness. You'd say to everyone, come on. You can do better. You can do better. You can do better. You can do better. And you get that, and you keep hearing that. It's like, wow. No nonsense. Discipline, no nonsense. Tough, no nonsense. So even the sweetest, kindest, most compassionate looking being ever was this ferocious, tenacious, no nonsense. Get after it, discipline. You know, so you say, wow. You know, so somebody really cares enough to not accept any idolatry at all. Say, oh, you're so wonderful, Ma, you're so beautiful. You're so beautiful. I just want to tell you how beautiful you are. And she'd say, well, just say, hey. You can't afford to slip on the path. You got to do more. What are you doing right now? Hey, I want you to do this. Be more intense. Come on. I say, no, I don't want to, but you're beautiful. I just want to tell you how beautiful you are. No. See? Rejected idolatry, said Taskmaster. Said, I don't care what you think about me at all. I'm telling you the straight talk. So that leaves a tremendous impression. I don't care what you think about me at all. Not one bit. I'm only telling you the truth, and your path has to be swift and brisk, and you got to burn those new grooves. So this is the intensity I'm conveying. It's hard to do that. I mean, me, when I'm faced with a person, I just grumble because, oh yeah, okay, I don't care what people think about me. But to get somebody in the world who absolutely does not care what anyone thinks about them. For me, that's the greatest thing of all. To have someone like that in the world, that's what I pray for all the time. Absolutely does not care what anyone thinks about him, ever, in the slightest bit. Then they'll tell you the truth. They'll give you the straight scoop. But most of us, we're so concerned about what people think about us. I do these tapings here. I'm not talking to anybody. So I can convey the intensity here. There's no, but with people, when I'm around people, I'm very solicitous. I don't say anything. I don't want them to think that I'm crazy or something, right? So that's a big problem, but we're all that way. Very rarely do we get people who truly tell it like it is. Very rarely. That's the greatest asset, pragmatic asset, practical asset. Now, of course, Jesus did the same and said, look, I don't even care if you kill my body. I'm going to tell you the truth. And if you say, I tell you the truth and you're going to kill my body, go ahead. I'm still going to tell you the truth. See? That's tremendous. People said, wow. He says, the world is nothing. The body is nothing. You want to hate me? You want to kill my body? Fine. I'm going to tell you the truth about the situation. But, again, right now, in this world, where do we get someone who talk straight? There are some people I've in the popular media and stuff. I'm not going to name names, but there are a few people who say, I don't care what people think about me. I'm gonna say the truth here on this news show, this television show, whatever. And when they do that, it's like a wrecking ball descends upon them. And their careers are completely destroyed. And so that terrorizes everyone. I mean, you know, we talk about terrorists. Who are the terrorists? Really? Is who brings the wrecking ball? Terrorists are already in control. They're the ones who are running the things. Absolutely. You cannot speak truth in this world without the wrecking ball descending upon you. At least, it seems that way, doesn't it? So, of course, people are very intimidated now. Very, very intimidated because they've seen so many. This has been going on for a long time. It's been going on throughout history, actually, hasn't it? But we think we live in such an enlightened age. But there's a set of beliefs now that has permeated our culture. That if you say, hey, this the Empress doesn't have any clothes, that this is not a true belief. This is mistaken. Off with your head. Immediately you get severely attacked like a swarm of wasps or hornets, you know. So who is there in the world who absolutely doesn't care what anyone thinks about him? Is it even possible to exist here? Because your career will be ruined. Okay, I don't know anybody who can, you know, have a career and make any money in this world and speak the truth at the same time. That's a question, isn't it? And very, very soon, who could even remain out of not in jail and speak the truth here? That's how severe the problem is here. We live in an ideological dictatorship. See, people say, well, it's coming. Okay, I think I see it. It's over there. No, we are living in it right now. We are in an ideological dictatorship, totalitarian police state dictatorship, that the thought police, we're already living in a thought police dictatorship. Right now, we're living in it. Now, you know, Jesus Christ told us true. He tells us true. Can we repeat what he said? In this day and age, I'm talking about both in 2,000 years ago and recently with a book, for instance, Journey Beyond Words, where he tells us the straight truth. There's nothing that can happen to anyone that wasn't their own choice that they experienced this. He says absolutely impossible that this ever take place. That is the straight truth. The ideological dictatorship here is that victims are always victims. It's a victim consciousness. And that victims never, ever, in any way, ever participated or had anything to do with their victimization, so to speak. That is the ideological, Nazi-like, totalitarian police state that we live in. Completely contrary to the testimony of our great Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who tells us the truth. Why is Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior? Because he says, hey, I'm walking beside you. So I'm walking with you. There are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. There are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. There are no layers, there are no levels, there's only zero. There is no time, it's a hallucination. You're hallucinating all of this. Okay. And even in this hallucination, everything that you experience, you requested it, you desired it. Now, why do people ask for things that seem terrible? See, we think, wow, how can we, to honor time. Continuity fear. They want to feel superior to someone else. Oh, you victimized me. I'm greater than you are. I'm putting the guilt on you. You're down there with your guilt. I'm up here with my righteous victimization status. Okay. So you may think that, where's Jesus? Where's the help? Is there any truth? No, Jesus definitely has told the truth to us. not only in the Bible, but in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, absolutely has told us the truth. It absolutely condemns this false hallucination of being greater than God, and this idea that something can happen to us that wasn't our choice, that it happened, that we experienced this. The crazy thing, though, about this hallucination is when you decide, hey, I want to be victimized, then it seems like this whole world rushes in to make the experience happen for you. Like that. It's scary. That's why I have to watch my thoughts, because someone, I think Jesus commented on this, like, you think, well, how come bad things happen to me so quickly and good things seem to take so long? And he says, because you want the bad things to happen to you so much more than you want because you want to honor time, so you don't want purity. You're afraid of purity. If you ask Jesus, I just want to experience purity, and he says, it doesn't happen for me. And Jesus says, because you're afraid of it. You're afraid of it. But you're so used to this contaminated corruption time experience that when you say, hey, I want somebody to do something that causes me suffering and misery, whatever, oh, somebody will show up like that to carry that out. There's no question. I've tried this out, and if you want somebody to kill you, oh, they'll show up like that. They'll show up like that. But if you want someone to liberate you from delusion, that seems to be, wow, it takes so long, takes so long, takes so long. Yeah, if you want to get into trouble in this world, trouble will find you almost instantly. Okay, and there's all a manipulation thing. Okay, so, you know, victimizer. Oh, you victimized me. You're lower than me. So it's a way they think of that they can get out of higher in this pit. They can raise themselves up on the guilt of others. You see, Jesus is very big on this in A Course in Miracles, how we use guilt to make ourselves feel higher. All right. So he's very much into the nuts and bolts of it in terms of guilt. This is very important. And he talks about forgiveness is very important. But it's possible to look at it in a more abstract, all-inclusive way, which is no layers, no levels, only zero. There's no layers, there's no levels, there's only zero. This doesn't get you out of the pit. It gets you to realize you never were in it. You never were in it. No one's ever been in it. The Vision of Oneness shows no one's in any pit at all. You literally see nobody's in a pit at all. You see everybody standing right here. We're all level. We're all on the same level. You see everything and everyone on the same level. Nobody's fallen in any pit at all. You see it. Literally, you see it. That's the Vision of Oneness. And then it's total relief. Oh my gosh, this is fantastic. I don't need to pull anyone out of a pit. There isn't any pit. Everyone's fine. And you're so happy. Not just for your sake. You're happy for everyone. You're just so happy to see nobody's in any pit at all. This is the Vision of Oneness. This is available to us. This is accessible to us. And yet we keep honoring time and think, so I can think I can be higher than someone else. If you want to be higher, you also think it's possible to be lower. So when you think yourself as lower than someone else, you're also expressing the desire to be higher than someone else. Now, when I looked at like Jesus and the Sri Nanamayama and Longchenpa, do I say, oh, I'm lower than them? No, never did. Never said, oh, you're so much greater, I'm so much lower. I said, what I'd say it was, you're so much freer of the continuity fear than I am. That's how I looked at it. Wow, you're free of the continuity fear, and I'm not. But you're not higher. I know you're not higher, and I'm not lower. It's just I have this continuity fear, so I'm not able to express the way you're expressing. So when these teachers have come to me and helped me out, I'm able to be helped because I don't go into this idling, this state of idolatry with them, or awe. I don't have awe, and I don't have idolatry. I say, wow, you're tremendous. How did you get rid of the continuity fear? That's what I say. That's fantastic. How did you manage to get rid of this continuity fear? This is incredible. What kind of advice do you have for me? So these teachers don't show up in your life if you're going to idolize them. People say, well, I got Jesus. I go to church, I got Jesus. Well, maybe. Some do, some don't, though. What they do is they got these grooves that the preacher grooves into them. Yeah, grooves. But that's not the same as being in the presence of Jesus. I've been in the presence of Jesus many times. The actual Jesus presence there. That's different. There's no continuity fear there. You realize, hey, this one knows, is totally aware, and I'm struggling with this continuity fear. But they're just right here beside me, just talking like, hey, you know, you can do it. You just have to keep working hard. Jesus also insists on a work ethic. Go faster. You know, the way this world's going to honor time is going to cause a problem for you, for everyone here. August 5th, I think, is another milestone in this world. I told you, it's July 15th, new phases started here, and this is the phase of this intense honoring of time in this world. Honoring the levels, layers and levels, honoring layers and levels here. Time, layers, levels, super intense. Okay, this is bad news. The good news is that we have the medicine for it. No layers, no levels, only zero. 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 Now Jesus said, if you know me and you do not profess the truth in my name, then I don't know you. See, I'll say I don't know you. Don't hide your light under a bushel. So I heard that. I said, wow, you know, I better not say anything. I need to try and speak the truth in the world. But speaking it, you know, I can't go to a grocery store and start speaking. It doesn't work. People are too freaked out. They said, no. I need you at a distance. I believe in levels and layers and depth. You can't just be directly right here telling me this stuff. I need to idolize someone. I need to put someone on a pedestal. I need distance. And I said, no, you don't need any distance. That's what I'm telling you. Oh, no, continuity fear. So, it's very difficult. I don't want to be put on a pedestal. Who wants to be put on a pedestal? That's false. That's not true. Yet people here will they'll insist on it. Or they'll insist that you don't say anything that would cause them to want to put you on a pedestal, which is, again, bogus, which means agreeing with layers and levels. And they say, well, see, I don't have any problem with idolatry because I'm not putting you on a high level. Well, I said, well, I didn't say anything so that you'd feel you need to, but zero-sum game here, right? Nothing's happening. That's not progress. That's a delusion of progress. I don't need any to work because I'm not idolizing anyone. Well, I said, well, I didn't say anything that would trigger that. I'm agreeing with layers and levels, you know, here. And so you say, oh, yeah, you agree with what I'm saying? No problem. If I said no layers, no levels, only zero, then you'd say, oh, you're way up there. You're high. You're some great godlike being. Oh, my gosh. So it was such a great distance, you know. And I said, see, now you do need to practice, don't you? And they'd say, ah, I don't like that. Get a distance from me. Get away from me. This is the trick, the trouble of the world. This is the trouble of the world. That's why Sri and my mom moved around constantly. So people would get back to their practice instead of trying to put her on a pedestal and idolizing her. She'd stay just a short time, then leave. And nobody knew where she was. She wouldn't tell anybody where she went. So people were looking for her in India. They go to India, where is she? Nobody knew. Nobody knew where she was. Because then they try, oh, we need to go see her. Oh, she's here, okay. This they start trying to build a cult of idolatry, you know, around her. But she just disappeared. Nobody knew where she went. Go somewhere else. Then disappear again, go somewhere else. So she said, look. And Jesus said the same thing. It's better for you that I leave this world than to stay, so you can listen to the Holy Spirit. So you do not try to idolize me, put me on some high pedestal. Because he knows that's the tendency, that's what will happen. I say, no, we want, the apostle said, no, we want you to stay with us, stay with us, stay with us. He said, no, no, it's better for you if I go. It's a cool breeze this morning. It's not going to be as hot as yesterday. They say it will be 98. Real heat spill here. Not horrendous, but, you know, 100, 98, 98, 98, stuff like that. Not bad. What's the affirmation? No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels, only zero. Again, what is the urgency of the times? August 5th, I'm saying, early August. Trouble. As if we don't have enough already. But we don't understand what's going on. What's going on, what is the honoring of time, which means depth, which means layers and levels, which means hallucination, which means delusion, which means spiritual pride, which means spirit's desire to be greater than God. That's what it means. So, all institutions in this world, almost without exception, if there's an exception, then it's an exception, and I accept it's an exception, fine, are into heavily into this honoring of time and have been cowed into participating in this, what's coming up. Francis, those who are spearheading this honoring of time, they love him. They say, wow, finally we got our Pope, the Black Pope, the Jesuit Black Pope. It's not a good thing what's happening there. But if some feel it is, fine. If they're getting some good out of it, fine. No objections from me. But the overall situation in the world is there's no hardliners anymore, you see, in institutions. Where are the hardliners? Gone with the wind. Where are those who don't care what anyone thinks about them? So this is the way, I don't care what anyone thinks about me. I don't need to be idolized. I don't need to be put on a pedestal. I don't need to be a populist. These are the disciplines that are necessary. This is how it's going to be. I don't care what anyone says. See, that's the role of the Pope. Well, the role of the Pope is not to be a populist. The role of the Pope, or any leader, is simply to say, this is the disciplines that are necessary, and this is what you need to stick to, and I don't care what anyone thinks about me, what anyone says about me. We're going to stick with this. This is it. That's what the world needs. Now, so August 5th, early August, 10 days from now, we better be ready. We're ready, but we better get that groove burned in. Okay, burn the groove in, no layers, no levels. No layers, no levels, only zero. No layers, no levels. 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 Only zero. So let's see what I'm going to do. I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe I'll help burn this in, because it has to be burned in the next 10 days. Okay, let me give some consideration to this. Very great, that's it.